So good evening and welcome to everybody. Thank you for waiting an extra couple of minutes in the waiting room. Thanks for hanging around. We just had a couple of technical issues we need to sort out. Now, I'm Alistair Dabbs. I'm Secretary of the NUJ London Freelance Branch. My role here this evening is purely as the technical host, trying to sort out any technical issues as they come along. But otherwise, I think people are still joining us. So hello, thank you for waiting. Can I just go through a couple of housekeeping? First thing is, you'll see that this is being run as a webinar, so you'll be able to see and hear us okay. No need to have a webcam or anything like that. I don't have to shout at anybody, please unmute yourself, because you don't have to. You can just watch us speak. When you want to ask questions, you can ask questions at any time throughout this webinar, which will be running for a maximum of 2 hours. You can use the chat window. So in the window that you're seeing us, you should see a button bar. There is a chat button you can click on and you can post your questions at any time. We'll be trying to keep track of those. And then towards the end, we'll go through some of those questions and invite some answers from the panelists today. So I hope that's all good. If you're seeing a Q&A button, I will check that, but we're not really using that. We're going to use the chat window. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pass over to my colleague, Elizabeth Ingrams, who will formally introduce everybody and this whole webinar session. So thank you very much for hanging on for an extra couple of minutes. I'm going to pass you over to Elizabeth. Thanks.
Hello, and welcome to this evening's webinar on nuclear risk reporting. I'm very, very happy to welcome you all to the London Freelance Branch Salon. The Salon events are meant to be relaxed events where we get the chance to invite speakers from a great variety of fields with a huge range of knowledge to share with us as a branch and as a union. And these events in normal times were very successful as live events. But since the pandemic, we found that we get much more participation, many more people wanting to join online events. So that's why this evening's event is online. So do feel free to treat this as if it were a salon event. So even though you're at home, feel free to pour yourself a drink or take a glass of wine and enjoy the evening's talks. So the aim of the event is that we will have a series of talks by 6 speakers, and we will then move on to Q&A after that. So if you've got a burning question that you want to ask a speaker, please do hold it and write it in the chat at the end when we've heard all of the speakers, because although I am a good chair, I have chaired many events, I won't be able to respond to those questions until we reach the end of the talks. So please go ahead and use the chat. However, do use the chat, do ask as many questions as you like. We have the time, and we have, as I mentioned, this amazing range of speakers and knowledge to draw on. So who am I and why am I introducing this event? So I'm a writer and researcher. I have recently focused on nuclear issues from a survivor's perspective because I came across the Hiroshima stories when I was living and working as a journalist in Tokyo, Japan, which was also an area, the precise area where I lived was an area where the first anti-nuclear petitions were started in the 1950s. I've spoken on the BBC and on London radio on the intergenerational impacts of nuclear weapons. And I've been a fixer for various BBC programmes on nuclear issues in relation to Hiroshima. I published and edited a volume of essays with Routledge on Japan and remembering. And I've also been a keynote speaker for the NUJ's recent anti-nuclear motions in 2016, 2018, and most recently 2021. the 2021 motion commits the NUJ to campaign for the adoption of the Treaty for the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons by the UK. I would now like to introduce Kyoko Gibson, who will talk about her experience. And I'm going to introduce Kyoko very briefly. She herself was born in Hiroshima in 1948. So therefore she's a second generation Hibakusha. This means that although she was not directly exposed to the atomic bomb, which was dropped on her city 3 years before, her parents were exposed. Kyoko's health has been affected by that experience, and she has lived with 50% immunity as well as various health problems, similar to those commonly found among children of directly exposed Hibakusha. She and her husband, Les Gibson, have started the website 1 Million Voices for Nuclear Abolition, which can be found at www.uknucleardisarmament.co.uk. Kyoko, if you would like to share your experience.
Thank you. Good evening. Thank you for inviting me to this meaningful event. This is my experience as someone who was born and raised in Hiroshima. I shall begin by saying that because English is my second language, and talking about my experience in Hiroshima is very difficult even now. So, not to become emotional, I will read directly from my prepared notes. I hope you don't mind. The late SGI President Jose Toda made a historical declaration about the abolition of nuclear weapon on the 8th of September, 1957, in front of 50,000 young people. When I was 8 years old, I heard Mr. Toda's declaration and its call for the destruction of this devilish nature lurking deep within the lives of human beings. His aim was to establish the idea that the use of nuclear weapons was an act that would deny humanity its fundamental right to exist. He hoped that by allowing this idea to penetrate deeply into the heart and the mind of people throughout the world, particularly the leaders in each country, and by establishing this internal criterion, he would prevent the use of nuclear weapons. He meant to crush the tendency in the people's mind to justify the use of nuclear weapons. His goal was to expose and rip out the claws that lies hidden in the very depths of such weapons. Mr. Toda was thus convinced that it is the existence of Buddha nature within human beings that would guarantee the abolition of nuclear weapons without fail. Since a human being created the atomic bomb, it must also be human beings that make possible its abolition. Since then, Mr. Daisaku Ikeda is the foremost peacemaker in the world, carrying on with this movement. He is 95 years old this year, but still works tirelessly for the sake of humanity. I didn't understand the depths of Mr. Toda's word at that time, but my mother clearly explained it to me, and it remained in my heart until today. Nobody has the right to take precious life. Everybody has the right to live life. My faith believes in the dignity of life because life is the most precious of all things. On the 6th of August, 1945, the atomic bomb was dropped on the city of Hiroshima with a population of 350,000. Hiroshima was apparently chosen because of the clear sky overhead that day. Good visibility made it easy to observe the destructive capacity of this new nuclear technology. Under that mushroom cloud, rising out a temperature of 5,000 degrees centigrade, as we know, water boils at 100 degrees and steel melts at 1,500 degrees. 70,000 died instantly, and many more afterwards. So within 4 months, 140,000 died. And to this day, people continue to die from radiation-related illnesses. The actual dropping of the bomb took only 10 seconds, but the effect have continued and will continue for generations. I was brought up in a community filled with the family suffering tremendously from the effect of the bomb. Although I was born 3 years after the bomb was dropped, no information was available as to the possible consequences. Because of that, people were ignorant of the effect of radiation. We grew and ate vegetables from contaminated soil and ate fish from the polluted sea. However, people like me and others who were indirectly affected by the bombing that day are not counted among the statistics. Even now, there is a lot of suffering behind the closed door. Marriage is very difficult, as it may produce babies with physical challenges. People had lost hope and confidence for the future because they felt that they didn't have the ability to provide for and care for their families and uncounted atomic bomb orphans who are not mentioned, never mentioned. There was a high suicide rate among victims and their families, and we did not use a condition called PTSD at that time. But there were many people who had PTSD. They saw loved ones who were melted in the front of their eyes. They witnessed the horror of many burned people crawling to the rivers and dying in the water. This was an absolute land of hell, man-made hell. I remember when I was small, even though nobody told me, but I know not to stare or ask questions about the people whose skin had melted with the intense heat. There are three groups of people in Hiroshima. The first one, still very angry about what had happened to their loved ones. The second group, it is too painful and it's past, so don't wish to talk about it. And thirdly, like SGI and other genuine people who dedicate their lives to ensure the peace and the security of the land. My family was no exception. All were affected physically and mentally in one way or another. Although I was born 3 years after the bomb was dropped, I was affected more than my siblings and had the most difficulty with my health. The only explanation was the after effect of radiation. Also, the mental and emotional stress that each one of us bore, because we didn't know what illness could be residing in our bodies and whether they could pass on to unknowingly to our children or grandchildren. One family I remember had their whole skin burned off by the heat. When you are skinless, your body is shiny and pink and in agony. It was horrendous to see. Some people managed to live on for years like this. Another neighbor had such a huge burn scar on his back, and he looked a bit like a tortoise with a shell. One day, the scar became very itchy, and his family said it was moving. Suddenly, from underneath the scar came a huge amount of pus and live maggots. I can never forget those images. And even now, after so many years, it is very difficult to talk about it. Can you imagine if you had lived with and watched those you care for and love undergoing such excruciating suffering? I was the weakest child in the family. I was told by my doctor that I had only a 50% effective immune system. My mother would encourage me each time I became ill by saying, "You have another opportunity to improve your physical karma." That kind of encouragement lifted my spirit every time. Even though I never heard her talking about the bombing, she would quote from the writing of Nichiren Daishonin saying, "Life is limited. We must not begrudge it. What we should ultimately aspire to is the Buddha land." She meant the land of humanity. I can feel from that my mother's determination for all of us to be happy. When I was a little older, I used to be involved in the peace movement. I carried a placard to demonstrate for peace. No more bombing, no more war, no more Hiroshima. Each time before I left home to take part in demonstration, my mother would gently shake her head and say, "You cannot change people's heart by carrying a placard." I would say, "I know, mother, but I know I want to change the world and change it now." But she never stopped me from doing it. However, she did ensure that I continued to practice the Buddhism of Nichiren Daishonin. One day, I heard a head of state say that he was horrified to hear what had happened in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And after giving a long speech with many condolences, then said, "But I am glad this didn't happen to us." It was then that I realized the truth of what my mother had said. This was my turning point. In 2003, Soka Gakka International, President Daisaku Ikeda made a peace proposal in which he talked about a life-sized paradigm for our age. He said, quote, "The way forward, I believe, lies in developing a life-sized paradigm by which to understand our world and where we stand in it." By life-sized here, I am referring to a way of thinking that never deviates from the human scale. It is simultaneously human sensitivity to life, a whole, and also the detail of everyday human existence. I believe it is an approach that is urgently required in response to the challenge of our age," unquote. When scientists develop the atomic bomb, and when those in power decided to use this weapon on people, and the bomber pushed the button, did they think that their action would have such devastating effect on all of those individuals who had names, faces, and felt the joy and sorrow of life? A few years ago, I saw documentary on TV about the bombing of Hiroshima, in which the interviewer asked the man who pushed the button on that day over Hiroshima, "Would you do the same thing again?" His answer was, "Yes." There are no words to express how I felt on hearing this statement. In September 2000, I returned to nurse my dying mother in the hospital in Hiroshima, which treats radiation victims. The doctors gave my mother 2 weeks to live, and my sisters and I stayed with her around the clock. One day I heard a voice from the radio coming from the next room to my mother. I soon realized that it wasn't the radio, but an elderly lady repeating over and again, "Mommy, it hurts." She was a little girl again calling out to her mother. She was a survivor of the atomic bombing who had lived so long and was ending her life in this way. When her sound stopped after 2 days, I wanted to scream on her behalf. Everybody knows that we should not destroy lives, but many don't know how to actually treasure life. I often used to feel overwhelming sorrow, but I know now how to transform hunger, anger, and foolishness, which all human beings have, into compassion, courage, and wisdom, and encourage others to do the same. In October 2006, I finally visited the Atomic Bomb Museum in Hiroshima, which I and my family have never been able to physically do. I entered the building by myself and renewed my vow to work for world peace on behalf of my late parents, elder sister, and the people of Hiroshima. I hope our voice are loud enough to ensure that this must never be repeated again. I am dedicating my life to creating the cause of peace rather than try to treat defect through the teaching of and the teaching and the philosophy of NUJ-LFB. There are still 13,100 nuclear weapons in the world, and 3,750 are actually active warheads. And still in many people's mind, nuclear weapons are necessary evil. I no longer carry a placard to demonstrate for peace, but have a huge banner in my heart for world peace. Hiroshima is now the most beautiful and peaceful city because there are many thousands of people practicing philosophy of deeply respecting the dignity of life. My hope is no children go through what I went through in their life ever again. So I will keep going in this humanistic work of abolition of nuclear weapon activity until the last breath of my life. Thank you for giving me opportunity to talk, and thank you for listening. Thank you.
Thank you, Kyoko. Thank you so much. I'm sure we'll be able to reflect on that in the questions. I'm now going to introduce our second speaker, Milan Rai. Milan has been editor of the Peace magazine, Peace News, since 2007. Before that, he was focused on non-violent direct action, including coordinating Voices in the Wilderness UK, which broke the economic sanctions on Iraq by taking children's medicines to Iraqi hospitals. Rai has been to prison 4 times for his peace actions, and he shared the Transport and General Workers Union's Frank Cousins Peace Award in 1993. Rai is the author of several books, including Tactical Trident, The Rifkind Doctrine, and The Third World, Drava Papers, 1992, Chomsky's Politics, War Plan Iraq, and 7/7, The London Bombings, Islam and the Iraq War, which was published in 2006. Among his shorter works are 1917, The Nonviolent Russian Revolution, which was published in 2017, and Nuclear Targeting the Third World, with Declan McHugh, which was published in 1992. Milan, over to you.
Thank you very much, Elizabeth. I'm very honoured to be part of this distinguished panel. My name is Milan Rai. I'm editor of Peace News, proud NUJ member. Please excuse me because I'll be leaving the meeting after putting forward my contribution because I'm suffering from a cold and I'm not going to last very long. Peace News has been going since 1936, standing up for non-violence and for non-violent movements for social change. My topic is how nuclear weapons actually function in British foreign policy and how they are used. The common picture of British nuclear weapons is that they are there to prevent the UK coming under nuclear attack. This is a propaganda construction designed to distract us from some ugly realities of our nuclear history and of British nuclear doctrine, past and present. There's a parallel history in the US, and it's summed up well by Daniel Ellsberg, who was a nuclear war planner inside the Pentagon at the highest levels. And he's the whistleblower who leaked the Pentagon Papers, the secret history of the Vietnam War. And Daniel Ellsberg wrote in 1981 that again and again, generally in secret from the American public, US nuclear weapons have been used for quite different purposes in the precise way that a gun is used when you point it at someone's head in a direct confrontation, whether or not the trigger is pulled. In the UK, I would argue that British nuclear weapons have not just been about defending the British homeland, they're being used right around the world. They've been aimed at non-nuclear weapon states as well as nuclear armed enemies. British nuclear policy has been about nuclear intimidation and coercion, as well as threatening retaliation against nuclear attack. Britain, in my view, has used its nuclear weapons to threaten other countries during direct confrontations in the Ellsberg sense, as well as in other ways. And I would argue that this policy of nuclear bullying is deeply embedded in British military planning and policy. It's come up to the 20th anniversary of the war. So I'll take the example of Iraq. US President George W. Bush signaled that there was going to be a war against Iraq in his State of the Union address in January 2002, the Axis of Evil speech. A couple of months later, the following on-the-record statements were made by the British Defense Secretary, Jeff Hoon. Hoon appeared in front of the House of Commons Select Committee on Defence on the 20th of March 2002, and he was asked by a Labour member of the Select Committee, Jim Knight, whether states such as, let us say, Iraq, would be deterred by our deterrent from using weapons of mass destruction against our forces in the field, i.e. the ones about to invade Iraq. Hoon said, of countries like Iraq, they can be absolutely confident that in the right conditions, we would be willing to use our nuclear weapons. A few days later, Hoon appeared on ITV's Jonathan Dimbleby show and insisted that the government reserve the right to use nuclear weapons if Britain or British troops were threatened by chemical or biological weapons. The remarks to the Commons Defence Select Committee, you can read them on Hansard online. For Hoon's remarks on TV, I have a different source, which is an article in The Guardian. I think this is right. Which is Richard Norton Taylor. You can still find this on The Guardian website. Britain's Bush's nuke bandwagon, and you, in the text down below at the bottom, he mentions the Commons Defence Committee, and then at the bottom, there's the bit about the Jonathan Dimbleby show. So the month after that, on the 29th of April, Hoon was in a debate in Parliament where he was pressed about his recent comments concerning the possible use of nuclear weapons against Iraq by a couple of Labour MPs. And Hoon said, ultimately, and in conditions of extreme self-defense, nuclear weapons would have to be used. He was pressed, like, what do you mean by extreme self-defense? He didn't clarify. He said it was important to point out that the government have nuclear weapons available to them, and that in certain specified conditions to which I have referred, we would be prepared to use them. He didn't actually explain what those conditions were, but they were kind of indicated by his earlier evidence and appearance on TV. In June, Guardian columnist Hugo Young wrote one of the very few mainstream media comments on these very public nuclear threats. And here is the Hoon's talk of preemptive strikes could be catastrophic, subhead: the defense secretary's defiance makes nuclear war more likely. And he went through the various nuclear threats that Jeff Hoon had been making that year. So Hugo Young actually had form as a mainstream journalist who was willing to refer in print to and comment on British nuclear threats, because in the run-up to the 1991 war on Iraq, Hugo Young had written about something that he had heard in terms of the British threats. So this is 13th of November 1990. This is the headline. It's Hugo Young's picture, and then down here it says, "I have even heard a minister say that a prolonged tank war might have to be ended by a Western attack with tactical nukes." So there are many other examples of nuclear threats against Iraq in 1990-91. I don't have time to go into them. These were nuclear threats against a non-nuclear weapon state. They're not aimed at deterring an invasion of or nuclear attack on British homeland. They're threats made to protect British troops on a military expedition to a resource-rich area. There are other examples of nuclear threats being made against non-nuclear weapon states, including Indonesia in the mid-1960s. These are actually connected, these aren't just examples of history, these are actually connected to British nuclear doctrine going right back to the beginning of Britain's nuclear history. Later this year, it'll be the 30th anniversary of an important speech by Malcolm Rifkin, then the Tory Defence Secretary, when Rifkin said that it was important for the credibility of our deterrent that the United Kingdom also possesses the capability to undertake a more limited nuclear strike in order to induce a political decision to halt aggression by delivering an unmistakable message of our willingness to defend our vital interests to the utmost. And it became clear from briefings that what Rifkin was talking about was threatening to fire a single Trident missile carrying a single, probably low-yield Hiroshima-scale warhead, and that would be used to deliver an unmistakable message of our willingness to defend our vital interests, not necessarily just the British homeland, but our vital interests around the world to the utmost. And that's my time. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Milan. That was a very, very powerful reminder of the extent to which we are in danger of using these weapons again. So I now want to introduce Janet Fenton, who is our third speaker. Janet Fenton is the director of Words and Action for Peace. Words and Actions is a new home for Secure Scotland and for peace and justice. She is a Scottish Quaker and eco-feminist, and she's active in the international campaign for the abolition of nuclear weapons since its beginning. And she has worked in community arts and was the founder of the Evergreen Trust. She has taken direct action with Trident Ploughshares, and in addition to ICAN and Peace and Justice, she holds positions with the Scottish Campaign for Nuclear Disarmament, Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, and the UN House in Scotland. She is a secretary to the Scottish Parliament's Nuclear Disarmament Cross-Party Group. Thank you so much for joining us, Janet.
Well, thank you, Elizabeth. And thank you so much to Kayoko, and also, of course, to Mill. I wanted to acknowledge the significance of opening this meeting in the way that we did, with that very powerful reminder of the reality of what happened in Hiroshima and why many of us got engaged. I'm 75 and I first was convinced of the need for nuclear disarmament when I read John Hersey's account of what happened there. I'm amongst a large number of people that came to it in that way. And I was thinking about that earlier in terms of talking to a bunch of journalists, because that's what John Hersey was, and the importance of your role in communicating these very significant messages. I started out as a nuclear disarmament campaigner, and other aspects to the thing soon fell into place for me. And the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom is a very important strand. And I was reminded of that today when our Scottish First Minister, who joined CND before she became the First Minister, has chosen to lay down that particular task. And I was reminded that she always claimed that she joined Scottish CND before she joined the Scottish National Party. But I think I would like to just use the little bit of time that I have to talk to you here tonight to just flag up some of the things that might be useful to journalists and the job that Mill has already done in noting some of the history and the citations that are available is obviously very important. But I'm recalling that I went to Geneva in, I think, probably 2011, thereabouts, and was asked to speak for the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom at a side event in discussions on the Non-Proliferation Treaty preparatory conference. And one of the people that I was staying with in Geneva had discovered a whole lot of archive photographs that he thought would be of interest to me and produced them the night before I had that task. And they were pictures of the maison in Geneva that was a home for the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom. And the image that struck me was an image of a bunch of women with prams with their children protesting, in fact, protesting outside the very room at the UN in Geneva where we were holding the meeting. The caption of the picture was, "We have had enough." And that was the banners these women were carrying. And this was in relation to atomic testing by France in 1962. And you think, well, if they had enough then, where are we? Why are we still doing this? And I think it's very easy to imagine that in the history, somehow something was missed and we got it wrong. But actually, something was missed and it was ignored, which is a much more dangerous and wrong-headed situation. The Women's International League for Peace and Freedom was founded at the beginning of the First World War, and it grew from the suffrage movement, and it grew from women who wanted the vote in order to stop the whole notion of war as a means of attempting to resolve transnational or international differences, ideological differences, or attitudes towards resources. And they were absolutely right. They had it absolutely on the button at that time. And so that is, that's still the struggle that we're engaged in. And one of the aspects of this meeting that Elizabeth suggested that we should be thinking about is risk. And I'm aware that I think that those women with their prams in Geneva were totally aware of risk and the idea that risk has two dimensions to it. And one is the probability of the thing happening, and the other is the severity of what will take place. So when you're talking about risk, you need to constantly look at what makes it acceptable to take a particular risk. So one of the things that was very forceful in gaining the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons was looking at the reality of the humanitarian consequences of any use of nuclear weapons. And so that when you're actually talking about risk, you're talking about the reality of what would actually take place. And as soon as you do that, it becomes very apparent that that is a risk that should never be taken. So there's a huge amount of resource that's available to journalists to really explore that if they're willing to open their minds to it. And in addition to what parliamentarians are saying, if you look at the history of the research that's been done on risk, Patricia Lewis' article in that she wrote for Chatham House at around that time on risk, there's in Scotland we've been looking at the risk that attaches to the nuclear convoys that are tracked taking warheads from Faslane into Coalport, and the risk that's attached to that, which is unexamined even in Scotland by our Scottish government, who have responsibility under the Civil Contingencies Act for protecting people in the event of something terrible happening. And I cannot imagine that there are many more things that are more terrible than a nuclear accident. And yet the risk that brings is assessed by the Ministry of Defence. It's not realistic. So please take advantage of the work that's been done on that. I think the link is actually in the chat now to the report that was done by NukeWatch, Unready Scotland. As far as that's concerned, I think that on the website of WILF International, there is a photograph, and that photograph is of a Scottish banner that was in New York. The WILF banner that was taken to New York was very I'm going to have to stop.
Oh, Janet, I didn't mean you to stop mid-sentence like that. I was just concerned about that we allow everybody time to speak, but maybe you'd like to finish the sentence in the chat and then we can find out what you were about to tell us about the banner. So I'm very happy now to introduce Phil Webber. So Dr. Phil Webber has been chair of Scientists for Global Responsibility since its creation in 1992. He began his career as a physicist, and he spent 12 years as a research scientist at Imperial College, where he gained his PhD in surface science. From 1981, Phil was active in the Scientists Against Nuclear Arms, one of SGR's founder organisations, and during this period, he co-authored London After the Bomb and Crisis Over Cruise. He was one of the organisers of the London Nuclear Warfare Tribunal in 1983, and in 1990, he wrote new defence strategies for the 1990s, and he worked on positive action through work in the environmental field, leading one of the UK's award-winning environment programmes in Kirklees Council, West Yorkshire, where he headed a 6 million per annum low-carbon renewable energy conservation and grants programme. And after that, he spent a short amount of time as a visiting professor at the University of Leeds, working on low-scale carbon. He was a director of a non-profit energy company, Yorkshire Energy Services, up to 2021, and he continues to contribute material about Trident, new weapon systems, the pervasive influence of the military, and pathways towards a low-carbon society. Over to you, Phil.
Thank you very much. It's worth saying that I grew up during the Cold War, and I started off thinking that deterrence was quite a good idea. It was a good idea to have nuclear weapons. However, once I became aware of the reality of nuclear conflict and what that would mean, I realized that I came to the conclusion that nuclear weapons were pretty much unusable in reality, and actually, in my view, useless. And that the idea of nuclear deterrence as such is a myth, we're told, that keeps us, supposed to keep us safe, but doesn't. One thing I would say on the topic of war in general, if you think of the far bombing of Tokyo or of Dresden, those created horrific apocalyptic scenes, people dying in cellars due to the oxygen taken out of the air. War is hellish. Nuclear war is concentrated hell. I don't think there's any doubt about that. And threatening it makes us all more unsafe. So could you just show the first slide for me, Alistair, please?
Okay, I'm about to do a screen share for you. Just hold on. Okay. I'll get that set off for you right now.
So that's just there's a lot of information on the SGR website. That's all that is to say, sgr.org.uk. Go there and there's more information than you ideally want. If you could go to the next slide, please. I put these slides together so that there's some background if people are interested and want to take this away. Could I have the first one that says 90 minutes to midnight? The one before this, thanks. Just recently, the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists, I've written in that publication myself in the past, but their panel decided that 2023 was judged to be the most dangerous in humanity's history. That's quite an astonishing statement. They set their nuclear clock, or their doomsday clock, to 90 seconds to midnight, which is the worst it's ever been. They quoted the following reason: a new heightened risk of nuclear war, a growing climate emergency, political systems, and I would say a mainstream media riven with dangerous and deliberate misinformation. I think think of Steve Bannon and flooding the place with shit, basically. That's his approach. A continued destruction of the natural world with the ideal conditions for new dangerous viruses and pathogens. We've seen COVID-19, we have bird flu, we have Ebola. At the same time, we're exceeding planetary survival boundaries, and we have the technical ability to create incredibly lethal pathogens. Recently, AI was found to be able to create things much worse than the worst nerve agent, for example, VX. So if I could go to the new next slide, please. So the first thing I'd say, which concurs entirely with previous speakers, so I think they were excellent presentations, is that the existence of nuclear weapons creates damage by just existing. And in fact, there, and I've listed what I think those are. Fear and uncertainty, crises are incredibly dangerous. The war in Ukraine is an example of that. Typically, we've had a nuclear serious miss every 3 years where people have nearly fired nuclear weapons. The only reason it hasn't happened is because people disobeyed their orders. In one case, a Russian submarine commander, in another case, a Russian colonel, incidentally. So we've avoided Holocaust by luck, I would say, for the last 70 years. The language is embedded with misleading language, which I call nuke speak, such as a minimum nuclear deterrent or a nuclear umbrella. It's not an umbrella. I think a better way was to say we have an unstoppable mega death threat. Now, nuclear deterrence is a misleading and slippery concept. You can't deter accidents, equipment failure, false alarms are worse, you have a false sense of security. It means you underfund real defenses. And in all of the scenarios where people do a simulation of a nuclear conflict, everybody loses. And that's why both Putin, Biden, predecessors have all said nuclear war cannot be won, must never be fought. And so what's the point of them? Next slide, please. So they're very dangerous when you don't use them, but in a sense, they're being used all the time, as our politicians say, but that's actually dangerous. So if you actually look at the effects of nuclear weapons, now the Hiroshima weapon was by today's standards tiny at about 15 kilotons. Modern weapons are 10 to 20 times larger. And we know, and recent, more up-to-date studies about what would happen with a modern city, you're talking about terrible immediate deaths and injuries, the equivalent of shelling a place for months and months. And we, a bit like creating a situation such as in many towns in Afghanistan, Syria, and Libya, for example, but in a few seconds. And without possibility of humanitarian assistance, medical facilities completely overwhelmed. I mean, you've seen just now with the earthquake in Turkey, medical facilities can't cope with that. One nuclear weapon could create more casualties than that in a few seconds. And then on top of that, you've got radiation. If you then go to regional nuclear war, scientists have looked at the possibility of a conflict between India and Pakistan using about 100 of these small Hiroshima-sized weapons. The results are horrific. So you're talking of hundreds of millions killed and long-term impacts caused by a 10-year nuclear winter with 2 billion people at risk of starvation across the world. Now, in 1983, people were starting to think that nuclear weapons could cause this nuclear winter. And I'll talk about how that is the case, but more recent, more accurate climate models have confirmed that, and it's worse than we thought, in fact. And I will provide references to that with these slides for later use for anybody who wants them. If you look at, and that regional nuclear war would affect the whole world, not just that region. So don't think you can have a war somewhere else and it doesn't bother you. If you're talking a global nuclear war, which would mainly USA and Russian warheads, 2,000 to 4,000 warheads, 2,000 of them are ready to fire in minutes as well, practically on launch on warning. You're talking of hundreds to millions to over a billion killed and injured. Radioactive fallout of huge areas, especially from nuclear reactors. A much worse longer-term nuclear winter, ozone destruction, the death of many species, possibly including humanity, and our so-called civilization very much at risk. So the next slide explains how and why that would happen. So nuclear winter causes extreme climate change because it, apart from the fires, it creates and firestorms, such as in Kyoto, Dresden, during the Second World War. The fires caused are inject smoke much higher into the atmosphere because of the power of the nuclear weapons. And that causes extreme cooling due to soot at high altitudes. And there's very robust evidence for this based on many volcanic eruptions, for example, which throw certain amounts of soot into the air. One example was Krakatoa, which meant there weren't any summers for the next year or two across the Northern Hemisphere. So next slide. So here's a load of graphs. So this is years, so over 10 years, this is the amounts of cooling. The top one is the regional conflict. The middle one is 2000 warheads. The other one is a global nuclear conflict. And just to give you an idea, minus four around the middle of the middle graph is equivalent to an ice age. So you've suddenly got an ice age lasting 10 years at least. And the shocking thing is that one Trident submarine firing its warheads at major cities, which is their intended target, although we're told they're not targeted at anyone. The reality is they've always been designed to obliterate Moscow, Leningrad, and other top big cities in Russia, plus a few military targets. But cities are military targets because that's where a lot of command and control is. So Trident alone could cause this effect. So you think you're there supposedly defending yourself with nuclear weapons, and you're actually, they're suicidal apart from being ecocidal. So the next slide, please. So one of our submarines contains 40 of these warheads at least. Each one, as you see, is 100 kilotons. That's eight times Hiroshima. At least 4 million fatalities and 10 million other casualties. If this is assuming they're fired at cities, we're assuming Russian cities, incredible fire zones. And the total explosive power is greater than the 6 years of World War II, including the two weapons dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. That's unarguable. It's a huge explosive power, and people just don't realize how much. So could you tell me how long I've spoken and whether I should continue saying any more? Somebody like Elizabeth?
Hi, Phil. It's time to wrap up, if you don't mind.
Okay. I put together some questions for people in later, if they're interested, which cover, I'll just tell you what they cover, is basically the fact that most countries don't want nuclear weapons, and some of them got rid of them. South Africa and New Zealand, Sweden. And I think there are, if you start looking at questions such as, would you press the button? This is a nonsensical question. And I've got some points to make about current UK military and nuclear policy, which is pretty much wedded to symbols of power. And it means, in fact, that we don't have defences that we could use. For example, we can see that in Ukraine right now. The defences that work are people on the ground, armies defending themselves. And threats of nuclear use don't help anywhere. They don't go anywhere. So I'll wrap up there. And thank you for the opportunity to make this presentation.
Thank you so much, Phil. So I'm very happy to welcome our next speaker, who's Elin Doyle. Elin is a playwright, an actor and a comedian, and her recent play Guinea Pigs premiered in London last year and is due to go on tour soon. The background to that play, which is based on a personal experience, is that during the 1950s and 60s, with the Cold War at its height, Britain threw itself into developing its own nuclear weapons. And during this period, a series of nuclear bombs were detonated in various remote Commonwealth locations, with among 30,000 British servicemen, many of whom were on National Services Service, sent to facilitate the tests and work in the cleanup operation afterwards. So witnessing the explosions with nothing but their ordinary shirt sleeves and trousers, they were given no protective equipment, and their only safety instruction was to shield their eyes at the moment of the flash. Many were so terrified by their experiences that their lives were changed forever. And in the first 10 years following those nuclear tests, government data shows that there were 303 deaths of nuclear test veterans, 148 of which were due to suicide or other forms of self-harm. 122 Army veterans took their lives, 68 of them were nuclear test veterans. The toll on mental health was undeniable, and as the years progressed, men began to experience a significant rate of illnesses, from rare cancers and autoimmune diseases, often leading to painful and premature deaths. Some later discovered they were unable to have children or had children with birth defects and other rare conditions with a higher rate of childhood illness and mortality. By the 1980s, enough men had suffered and were suffering that they could no longer ignore the link between their time at the nuclear tests and the subsequent health consequences. And a campaign began for recognition, which continues to this day. Many of us in the NUJ will know about that because it's something that the Mirror newspaper took up. Many were convinced that they were used as human guinea pigs after top secret documents uncovered from the period stated the aims of the nuclear tests were to discover the detailed effects of various types of explosion on equipment, stores and men, with and without various types of equipment. Thank you very much.
Hello. I feel quite in awe following on from the speakers that we've had so far, and I'd very much echo what Janet said, that it was incredibly moving and powerful to hear Kyoko's testimony at the beginning, which really just is a reminder of the humanity of the individual human consequences. And I guess that was the reason also why I wrote Guinea Pigs, the play. In the mid 1950s, my mum was a teenage girl, just having left school with a couple of O-levels. She lived in Reading. She came from quite a humble kind of working class background, but she was very keen in science. And she got a job with a firm called AEI. And her words were that she discovered that over the fence, the firm called AWRE, or the organisation called AWRE, which was the Atomic Weapons Research Establishment in Aldermaston, were paying more and also offering night classes. And she wanted to continue her studies. So the best option as a teenage girl back then was to get a job where you could take night classes. And so she jumped the fence, as it were, and as a 17-year-old found herself working as a lab technician on the production of the atomic bomb. In fact, my mum's job, she tells a story that her job was working to calculate the critical mass of uranium. I don't understand what that means. It means something to somebody. And so they would set up the experiment and then they would watch the two elements approach each other and take record. She said actually that there was one occasion where she was saying to her boss, or they were kind of commenting, that it was still climbing, and they all went off for lunch and came back to find that actually they'd very, very much just missed what could have been quite a serious nuclear disaster. And her boss was very quickly sidelined elsewhere. And in that job, it's where she met the love of her life, who was a 19-year-old. And he was a similar background, a young lad who was interested in science. And he was working in the detonation side of things. And that was my dad. And they met over evening class studying physics A-level. As part of his national service, my dad was then given the opportunity to go as a civilian, civil servant, to work as a technician on the nuclear test at Christmas Island. And so in 1957, he went there and he witnessed the explosion of Grapple X, so part of the Operation Grapple series, which happened on the 8th of November, 1957. And it was the first ever hydrogen explosion. So to give you an idea of size, I believe that the Grapple X explosion was 104 times more powerful than the bomb that was dropped on Hiroshima. And as just described, he stood there with no protection whatsoever, along with all of the other young men that had been sent. And I could recount verbatim what the experience was, because he would describe that to me. There were 22,000 roughly British young men who were sent mostly as part of their national service, so the average age would have been about 18-19, and a lot of them didn't have much choice what they were going for or even know what they were going for. Of the 22,000, there's around about only, I believe, around 3,000 or 4,000 who are still alive. But what a lot of them discovered in the intervening years was that, you know, as you might expect, health issues related to having been exposed to such a situation, and also then in their descendants. We've been affected as a family. And in the 1980s, my dad was very much involved in the early kind of campaign for justice and recognition as part of what was known as the British Nuclear Test Veterans Association, or the BNTVA, that was set up by a very feisty, admirable man called Ken McGinley, who's now an equally feisty 86-year-old from Paisley in Johnston. They really kind of mobilised to seek compensation or recognition, really, from the British government. That's still ongoing, because actually the UK is the only nation, or the only nuclear nation, to still refuse to acknowledge any correlation between having been at the nuclear tests and the impact on the families and their descendants. And I grew up in the 80s, really with that as the backdrop to my early teenage years, and it hugely influenced me, who I am. And so I wanted to write Guinea Pigs as a, not to tell the story, tell my story. It's not directly about my family. I've changed that. It's about a fictitious family, but very much the fact is rooted in my family's experience. And I wanted to do it against the backdrop of the 1980s, where it felt like people were mobilising, and include things like also the fight against apartheid, which was seen, you know, in some, you know, at times gone by, seen as quite niche. And now we would all absolutely agree that apartheid was a terrible thing and had to be ended. And I just wanted to show how attitudes change, and that sometimes actually the people who are seen as being a little bit outside of the mainstream are actually the people who have the right message. And the idea of the play is really centered around a daughter, a young girl called Coral, and her dad, who's a nuclear test veteran. And they are two peas in a pod, but the one thing that they can't agree on is Hiroshima. Sorry, that was my timer to make sure I don't waffle on too much. But the one thing that they can't agree on is Hiroshima, the need for nuclear weapons, and so sparks fly and stuff happens in the play. My hope then is therefore that we'll be able to tour it next year. We opened in London, really well received by the people that saw it. And it was lovely actually that we had people from all sides of the nuclear community and with different interests. We had some fantastic women who were protesters at Greenham Common come and see the show and be really supportive. And within the same audience, we had people who were nuclear test veterans and their descendants. And it was great to have that debate, as well as people who didn't know anything about the story at all. But that's where I come from. It's very much a personal story. I don't know an awful lot of the facts other than the facts of my family. And I just think it's absolutely appalling, but also pretty much par for the course, I think, the fact that we are still waiting for recognition and an apology. When actually other nations have done that, and to a degree, even including Russia. So we are really are the bad apples. And that's my story. So I'll end it there.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Ian. And I really recommend going to see the play when it's on again. I saw it online, and I found it very, really, really moving, and So I can only imagine that live it would be even more impactful.
Thank you, Elizabeth.
I'm going to now introduce Ben Donaldson, who's our last speaker this evening. Ben joined the UNA UK in 2011, and in 2013, he co-launched the 1 for 7 billion campaign, an international initiative widely credited with revolutionising the way the UN selects its Secretary General. As UNA UK's head of campaign, he coordinates the charity's Together First campaign to give civil society a greater voice in global decision making. He also leads the organisation's policy work on arms control and disarmament, with a particular focus on international processes and UK advocacy to improve nuclear security, ban lethal autonomous weapon systems, and regulate arms exports. Ben represents the organisation on various international coalitions, including ICAN, the International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons, as well as the Campaign to Stop Killer Robots and Control Arms, and he is a member of the UK Working Group in Arms and Rethinking Securities Council. Between 2014 and 2019, he coordinated the all-party parliamentary group in the United Nations. Over to you, Ben.
Thank you very much, Elizabeth, and thank you to all the panelists that have gone before me. I feel like there's already been such a rich debate on this issue, and it just reminds me how many different angles and how equally valid those different angles are that people are coming at this issue from. I wanted to use my slot to highlight a trend which isn't getting much pickup in the UK mainstream media, and then talk about the UK's role in this trend, and also debunk this notion that some of the speakers that have gone before me have touched on, this notion that the UK's nuclear weapons do not have any victims associated with them. So for a long time, the UK has gotten away with very little media scrutiny of its nuclear weapons. There's this accepted narrative that they keep us safe, they're prestigious, they make us a respected country, and they're a deterrent that as long as we don't fire them, they're not doing anyone any harm. And of course, there's this hyper-masculine sort of fetishization over would a responsible prime minister be willing to press the red button? And this always rears its ugly head during the prime ministerial hostage debate. And it's kind of a tragedy that this is like what the UK debate on nuclear weapons is often reduced to. So while the UK media opinion of the UK's nuclear weapons seem to be locked in a kind of stasis, opposition to any state owning a nuclear weapon is massively rising, as are the risks of nuclear weapons being used. So it's anything but sort of static at an international level. The former Secretary General of the United Nations said just over 10 years ago that the world is overarmed and peace is underfunded. That was Ban Ki-moon, when global military spending was just over $1 trillion per year. And 10 years on, figures show that global military spending has more than doubled to well over $2 trillion. And we know from history that this story does not end well. And there's this nuclear element to this issue. And that is that all countries with nuclear weapons are currently modernizing and upgrading their nuclear weapons. And in the UK, a conservative estimate for how much this is going to cost the taxpayer is $179 billion over the next 30 years. And indeed, a recent parliamentary committee, which was published pre-Ukraine, confirmed what analysts across the world have been saying, and that is that nuclear risks are rising. So as a response to this disturbing direction of travel, there's this huge global effort to counter this trend. And this is the bit that, with one or two exceptions, it's getting almost no pickup by the UK media. And that's that 139 countries, that's 70% of the states in the world, support this nuclear ban treaty. These countries all believe that Russia's illegal invasion of Ukraine makes the nuclear ban treaty even more important and means that a renewed effort for nuclear disarmament is something we should work on far more urgently. The UN Secretary General has also stated something similar to this. But media organizations, if they do report on this at all, and they tend not to, but if they do report on this, they tend to dismiss it and pick easy targets like civil society, individual activists, often individual female activists, to label them as peaceniks, or even Russian or Putin sort of apologists, while ignoring the wealth of global support for this powerful treaty and the wealth of support from UK allied nations, such as Austria and Ireland, And many other powerful countries in the world, including, for example, Mexico, Nigeria, New Zealand, South Africa, that all support this treaty. But instead of going to these countries and listening to, you know, statements by New Zealand's prime minister or Austria's foreign secretary about why disarmament is so important in the context of Ukraine, they tend to just pick on civil society activists, basically. It's worth also pointing out that from a pragmatic perspective, it's often countries that that post-Brexit, the UK is trying to do trade deals with, such as New Zealand and Mexico, which are also which are supporters of this treaty and, you know, puts the UK in a certain tension with them. And then there's a large part of the nuclear ban story, which is actually happening outside the national level. We've already heard from Janet about what's going on in Scotland and how the Scottish sort of First Minister and government is unambiguously committed to supporting the nuclear ban and hopes to be in a position to curtail all involvement in nuclear weapons policy in the future. Also, there's something happening at a sort of financial divestment level, because major international banks, financial institutions across the world are divesting from nuclear weapons. I think there's 58 major financial institutions at the last time I checked that have already divested from nuclear weapons production and from the supply chain. So there's that dynamic as well. There's also cities across Britain. So this is the sub-national level, cities and councils across Britain, including Manchester, Edinburgh, Oxford, Brighton, Norwich, Leeds. They've also signed up to the TPNW, that is the Nuclear Ban Treaty, and are committed to advocating that the national government joins it. And what's the UK's reaction to the nuclear ban been? Well, they've basically protested about it. When the nuclear ban was being negotiated in New York, when the Pope and Hiroshima survivors were gathering in a room in New York to discuss how to achieve a world free of nuclear weapons, the UK diplomat literally wheeled a lectern up outside the negotiating room, stood next to Donald Trump's diplomat, Nikki Haley, and branded everyone going into that room as misguided. And to the rest of the world, this looked incredibly sort of petulant and uncompassionate and juvenile, and that's being generous. So this was kind of an international embarrassment to our country that was not widely picked up by the UK press. And then since then, it's just been using opportunities to attack the nuclear ban. It's boycotted conferences. It's been releasing statements, including joint statements with Russia and China, as well as with France and USA, about how the rest of the world are so misguided in their views about nuclear weapons and how we will never join this treaty. And it's been dismissive of civil society and really anyone that supports the treaty. And so that's the UK's perception of the UK government perception of the treaty. And the press has given them kind of an easy time without scrutinizing that position too much. The last thing I want to mention is this the sort of colonial dynamic that this whole issue brings up. And this there's a particular focus within this treaty on Kiribati. And we've already heard about we've just heard about some of the things that went on the Christmas Islands. And this is a particular interest to this nuclear ban treaty, because of course this is where, as we've just heard, the UK tested a lot of its own nuclear weapons. It's where it developed thermonuclear bombs. It basically nuked this what is now a sovereign country 9 times between 1957 and 1958. Then it let the Americans nuke that country a further 24 times. And this, throughout this time, it was under UK colonial control. And it's always important to ground discussions on this in sort of humanity and the humanitarian impact of what we're actually talking about, the real life consequences of these. I'm so grateful to Kyoko for you know, bringing us together and really thinking about how this affects human beings, because first and foremost these are weapons that cause harm. They're not political tools. They are first and foremost weapons. And on Kiritimas Island, there were 500 locals living who all received very little protection during the nuclear weapons tests. And there of these islanders, I think there's about 48 first generation survivors and a further 800 children and grandchildren of these survivors. Many have Many have health problems consistent with radiation poisoning, blindness, hearing problems, cancers, heart disease, soft bones, reproductive difficulties. You know, the list goes on, but this is a massively understudied group and underassessed needs that are in relation to some of these harms that were caused. Sometimes the islanders were taken offshore during tests, but not always. And one Kiritimus islander that I spoke to, who now lives in the UK, was too young to remember the test herself, but recounted what her older sister experienced. And I'm quoting her now. And she said, it was a very scary time. During those tests, they were either taken on board the ship and put in the manhole of the ship, or they were put on a tennis court and covered with a tarpaulin. My sister had a baby son, and when the bomb exploded, the light was so bright she could see all the bones in her baby's body as she held him. When she looked at the other people sitting next door to her, they all looked like skeletons. My sister didn't live long. She died in her mid-40s. Her husband died in his 50s, and my nephew died in his 40s. We wonder why my sister and her family died so young. Now, work through this treaty on victim assistance and environmental remediation is a major part of the nuclear ban treaty. And again, the UK diplomats boycott all these meetings, and they get a very easy ride for doing so. And the last thing I want to say is that there are two very, very specific opportunities for the UK media to scrutinise the UK government on this issue that will come up over the next couple of years. There will be key moments for mass media engagement. Firstly, they're starting a process for a comprehensive assessment of the environmental damage and the health effects of the UK's nuclear tests. The UK will be asked to participate in this because, of course, it holds classified and privileged information as to what went on. So it's kind of a crucial component in this assessment. If the UK refuses to participate, and every indication is that the UK will refuse to participate, then, of course, that's something they should be called out for. The second thing is that there will be a trust fund set up for states to pay into in order to facilitate this programme of work. And again, if the UK refuses, and it has said that it will refuse to engage in this process, then that's another opportunity for sort of for media engagement. I want to finish at that point. I'm really looking forward to any sort of questions and the discussion that continues. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Phil. So that concludes the speaker part of the evening, and we'll now move on to questions. So make sure that you give yourself a stretch if you've been sitting down all this time, and I hope that the panelists will stay with us to discuss some of the questions that we have been coming in, which I've been very, very interested to read. So I'll start with the first question. So we have a question which came in from Phil Sutcliffe, who is a longtime member of our branch. So thank you for being here, Phil. So thinking about now about our conventional forces, which are arguably underfinanced, or at least financed less and less relative to inflation, does this situation increase the possibility of the first use of nuclear weapons by the UK? Does our substantial supply of weapons to the Ukraine play into these possibilities too? For instance, the idea that there's no alternative because the UK has decided not to acquire the alternatives. So I think that's basically sort of talking about the whole narrative that when Russia's been threatening us with nuclear weapons, and it's said that because their military is underfunded, it's more likely that they would resort to a nuclear weapon as a kind of cheap alternative. And so I think Phil is turning that argument around and saying, well, we're also less funded militarily than before, so would we use a so-called cheap alternative? I think that's what Phil meant. Correct me in the chat if I'm wrong, Phil. And I'd like Phil, Dr. Weber, to address that first, if that's okay.
Yeah, well, I did write a chat response. I hope they're not stupid enough to think that nuclear weapons are a good idea. And the other question is, it's very difficult also to think what possible advantage you gain by doing so. For example, if we use nuclear weapons inside Ukraine against Russian forces, you'd also kill an enormous number of Ukrainians. So that doesn't make any sense. So then you'd have to say, okay, well, let's use a nuclear weapon against a target in Russia. Well, if you do that, surely you'd have to expect a nuclear response. So I just can't see any sensible use. The trouble is that lots of the people who talk about this are clearly not what I would call sensible people. They're very arrogant. They're very one-sided. They think their threat is all that counts. They don't think through what the response would be. And Putin's made the point, and I think he's sort of got one, actually. He says, because we've got nuclear weapons and you've got nuclear weapons and everybody's got this nuclear umbrella, which is a real misnomer, we can hold conventional wars underneath that umbrella. And that, in my view, is what's going on now. And everybody's rattling these hyper-masculine symbols, as Ben correctly calls them, and saying, look, I've got a big totem over here. I've got a bloody great nuclear weapon. But I hope that is a stupid point of view. But I once had the experience in the NATO command bunker talking to NATO war plans. And they said, oh, well, if there's a mass tank attack, we'd fire a warning shot of a small nuclear weapon to say to them that they're serious, and we believe that would make them withdraw. And I said, are you serious? Are you serious? Do you think if you fired a nuclear weapon, they wouldn't take that as a provocation and respond in kind? And they got really shirty when I said that. And they didn't want to answer it because they hadn't thought about it. And other people have said the same thing. This whole idea of the nuclear threat is a one-sided argument. People don't think it through, except when they do the big simulations and they discover, shock horror, that nobody wins, everybody loses. It's a bit like in war games, the film. The only way to play is not ever to use them, in which case you have to say, well, what's the point? We all say that chemical weapons, biological weapons are terrible, must never be used. So we should say the same about nuclear weapons. And most countries don't want them. Some countries have got rid of them. You know, not everybody's not bombing Costa Rica, Mexico, and New Zealand because they don't have nuclear weapons. It's an absurd argument. Anyway, that's my answer. Really annoyed.
Thank you, Phil. I think also it's a good reminder of how, you know, recently quite a few, I presume due to declassifications, quite a few histories are being written about the Cuban Missile Crisis. And one of the things that comes out in all those histories is the closeness to which we got to nuclear conflict, and that when it comes to very high stakes kinds of diplomacy like those, it comes down to some very small actions and moments where individuals have to make monumental decisions under huge pressure. And so far, they have made those with an awareness of consequences. And it's really what you said there, I think, that really struck home was, to what extent are we aware of consequences these days? How much are we, are our leaders also, as well as us ordinary people, mindful of when we make these threats and, you know, and conflicts do occur, which they always will, to what extent are the people who are in charge of these weapons going to be thinking of the consequences? And surely an event like this, which is to raise awareness and to spread awareness about nuclear weapons use and the risk of their use and the risk of the what we've heard of the intergenerational consequences of nuclear weapons, that's really, I think, that one of the tasks that we need to at least take account of. So we've got another question here. Which isn't the risk So this is from Alistair Dabbs. Oh, yeah, Alistair Dabbs, who's the branch secretary of the freelance branch of the NUJ, who said London Freelance Branch. He says, isn't the risk pretty high that the UK, as a country that has been in a weak position since Brexit and badly handled the pandemic, is keen on demonstrating that it is still some sort of global player and could therefore become one of the forces less reluctant than others to either press the button or push it anyway, whether deliberately or based on misjudgment? We have heard so much in the recent past about errors of judgment. So how high could this risk be? So, Phil, you've just asked one question and you're being asked another, but I'd also like to bring Ben in on this, I think he would have an interesting point of view, perhaps, to express.
All I would say is that my opinion is, I hope they're not that stupid, but I wouldn't like to bet on it. I wouldn't like to bet against them being that stupid. That's one thing, because I think the arrogance, let's put it this way, the politicians were chosen because they supported Brexit, which was clearly based on a pile of lies. And so you're already selecting from a pretty poor bunch of politicians. And there's clearly massive corruption throughout politics in the UK, quite apart from everywhere else. It's really, the whole saga recently has challenged any belief I had in political parties. It's deeply distressing, I find. So what was the other bit of the question? It's gone out of my head. Sorry.
So the question, just to remind you, was so that would, because of the desire to kind of prove, I suppose, sort of what Ben called the
masculinity,
yeah. To prove yourself as a global player, that you become less reluctant to press the button, or you know, that could be deliberate or just based on an error of judgment.
I hope not, but what staggers me is the level of arrogance and the sort of statements from recently from MPs who are talking about we need to be on a war footing, almost gleefully saying, are we now really at war with Russia? And people talking about sending in UK troops openly. Obviously, there's a few, I dare say there's some special forces lurking in Ukraine already, but to say that, it's incredible that they say this. I can't remember the names of the people. I can see their faces, but I can't remember the names. But there's been very recent statements to that effect. Anyway, I'm sure Ben will remember, hopefully. Maybe.
Thanks, Elizabeth. I will just chip in with, I think the level of sort of strategy and rational thought that goes into the UK's nuclear weapons posture is probably overstated. I think there's a lot of people that feel comforted by the fact that there's doctrines and orthodoxy upon orthodoxy that really exists. But all the indications were that when Boris Johnson increased the UK's nuclear posture, and let's remember that he rolled back on the UK's transparency for various sort of operational information about the UK's nuclear weapons. He said that we're not going to tell you know how many nuclear warheads we're putting in our submarines anymore, and these sorts of things, and roll back on a lot of transparency, and also increase the cap on the UK's stockpile, saying we want to produce more warheads, and we're not going to tell you exactly how many, but we're going to increase the cap to allow us to do so. So there were these quite stringent measures that UK put on itself, conditions it put on itself as part of what it was trying to, you know, as part of trust building for other countries. So that other countries kind of knew what the UK was about when it came to nuclear weapons. Now, Boris Johnson rolled back on a lot of that and took his entire party by surprise. He took his allies by surprise in doing this. And most people think he just wanted to look big. And it was a hyper-masculine thing again. And he wanted to be able to basically create a trap for Keir Starmer at the dispatch box after the legacy of Jeremy Corbyn. And he wanted to create a trap for Keir Starmer to say, isn't that a bit irresponsible, Boris Johnson, by doing that with your nuclear weapons? And Keir Starmer, instead of falling into this trap, just actually tried to out-masculine Boris Johnson. And it was grotesque, the two of them facing each other down at the dispatch box, both trying to appear more strong, like they were more committed. And Keir Starmer even said it was there is no circumstance upon which the UK would ever consider getting rid of its nuclear weapons. We're actually in contravention of the Non-Proliferation Treaty, which is the one nuclear treaty the UK seems to quite like. He said it's unthinkable. Can't remember the exact that wording he used, but there was no circumstances the UK would ever consider disarming. It appeared that the extent to which this took the British defence establishment, the Defence Select Committee chairman, the UK's allies by surprise, that this was just made up by a party leader and just said because it was an easy thing to say. But of course, it means different things in different parts of the world when you have a domestic leader that appears to be off the rails like that. Because it could be interpreted very differently in different parts of the world. If someone's just suddenly saying, well, we're increasing our nuclear posture, and it appears to, and if he was just doing it to sort of seem hard and, you know, to quell his backbenchers who wanted him to appear tough on China and lay a trap for Labour. So I would say there's a lot less rationality there than a lot of the defence establishment think. Yes, it's a mess. That's my contribution.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Ben, for saying it so clearly. I think that we've all been very, very disappointed by lowest common denominator kind of discourse going on. We've had a comment here. I think it's more of a comment than a question. Why has there been so little information in the media about Britain's colonial past and nuclear weapons? So I think that was brought out. Obviously, Ellen's play is all about that, and Ben's stated research and forthcoming highlighting of Britain's nuclear legacy, especially in terms of Kiribati, is very, very relevant to that. I think there's more research to be done. I don't know if anyone heard Matthew Syed's very good programme earlier in the year, which was a series of four or six, I can't remember, I think it was a series of at least four programmes, which were all about nuclear history. And it started actually with the 1950s nuclear test. And it was a very interesting starting point. He avoided the issue of Hiroshima, interestingly, but he did start with the post-war legacy, Britain's post-war legacy of nuclear arms. So hopefully more information is going to be shared, but that is an absolutely vital area for future research. There are three new messages here. Alistair? Phil, yes?
I was just going to say, I think a lot of it's because they're non-white people in a distant country. I'm afraid I think it's inherent racism. I can't think of any other thing. How do I put my hand up and things like that? I'm trying to work out where that's hidden. On the screen, I mean.
Oh, right.
It's fine. I saw your hand.
I know, but I know I can do it electronically.
There's a button at the bottom which says raise hand.
Speaking of which, Eileen has it, her hand up.
And Eileen has her hand up as well.
I was just going to say, I absolutely echo what Philip said about this. I think the government that we have at the minute is they describe Boris Johnson as a runaway shopping trolley, but I mean, that's, I know that he's not in charge at the moment, although he'd very much like to be back influencing. I think my feeling is that, there's no thought or sight that stuff just falls out of people's mouths. And that actually we are, as a result, in a really dangerous place. And to the point about why we don't know about the impact of the nuclear tests, be it on our own citizens or the people that we inflicted it upon. And I remember having an Australian lawyer who was representing the Aboriginal communities in the 1980s come and visit when I was quite young. But I think it goes back, I agree that it's racism, but I think it goes back to the whole reason why we don't discuss any of our history that's relatively ugly in this country. We don't cover any of it. We don't discuss it. We have this perception of ourselves as always being, you know, the ones that got it right, the people that ran one World War II. I know that this isn't anything new that I'm saying, but you know, it feeds into everything, and I, you know, so we don't cover it. I think there's definite suppression of the test veteran story, and that extends out, and it's because it's an ugly part of our history, and so we don't look at it and we don't acknowledge that it exists, and we continue like that.
Yes, I agree, and yet at the same time I think we can take hope from the huge gains that have been made by both the environmental movement and also the Black Lives Matter movement, and that I think that as a country, when things are made, put in the public eye and in an unavoidable way, we are a country that is capable of self-reflection. And I think that somehow we have to continue to make noises and waves in this area, and obviously in many other areas, because I think it's our only option. Alistair, can you see any more questions?
I don't know if you want to have a quick check in the Q&A as well. There are a couple of posts that went in there, but I'm just going to scroll back up and have another check, because they were...
I was asked for a link to the treaty on the prohibition of nuclear weapons, which I put in there, and also a little bit about what it was, what it covers. Because I was asked about that, so I put that in the chat.
Okay.
I did have a passing question on the way, which I put in, that when I was a student in the 80s, protests against nuclear weapons and protests against nuclear power were very much closely linked. The saying at the time was, well, you generate nuclear power and you can make weapons out of it. Can that be separated now? Because nuclear power is very much in vogue amongst a certain group of ecological warriors?
I'd say directly no. In fact, I think the links are clearer. The only reason the UK funding, I mean, the funding for Hinkley, for example, is incredibly expensive for everybody. And then the plant on the south coast, which name just escapes, Dungeness, is it?
Mm-hmm. Dungeness. Yes.
Yeah. Anyway, Sizewell, that's it. Yeah. Those, they don't stack up. Everybody who's in any way independent, and most economists say, it's crazy, don't do it. This just doesn't stack up. But the reason they're doing it is to get hold of some nuclear expertise, because they want to build these so-called modular, which means little, nuclear reactors to go in our nuclear submarines, and they don't have people capable of doing it. And that's, if you read the minutes of the Infrastructure Commission, which is part of the UK government, they keep flagging up this program as being undeliverable, high risk, marked red, can't do it. And they say the same about building the blooming dreadnought submarines and things like that. The whole thing is an utter wasteful shambles, and the links are extraordinary between nuclear power and nuclear weapons. There are also incredible risks, and I published an article recently about risks of the Zaporizhia site and Ukraine war. If any nuclear reactor in even a conventional war is at very high risk, because a nuclear reactor can basically boil over if the electricity grid is cut, because it then relies on diesel backup generators to cool the thing, even if it's been switched off for weeks. And the Zaporizhia site and other sites in Ukraine have continually been cut off from their grid. And that's a huge risk, not just for the reactor. There's a huge amount of nuclear waste stored all around it. There's massive cooling ponds full of radiation, and there's a great big city built next door to the nuclear reactor, Enerhodar, just a couple of kilometers away. It's an accident waiting to happen. It's an accident waiting to happen in peacetime, let alone in a conflict. And that means a nuclear conflict. You don't need a nuclear weapon to create a disaster there. I don't agree with the person who thinks that nuclear is the only way through the nuclear contribution. I'm not against some nuclear reactors per se, but Hinkley's very expensive. We do have the technology moving on to dealing with the climate crisis. We have all the technology we need. We don't have the will, and we're not willing to give up our levels of consumption, and no government so far has grasped that. And we haven't yet managed to decrease our emissions in reality at all. And when the UK says it has, what it's done, they've exported the emissions to China, because now we buy a lot of stuff from China. There are emissions. Just because they're emitted in China doesn't mean they're Chinese emissions. So I'm afraid it's there are ways, and there's loads of plans showing from all sorts of people, lots of universities, the Centre for Alternative Technology, you name it, across the world, it can be done. The science is there. We can stop emitting these dangerous amounts of fossil emissions. But nuclear isn't the answer. We're being sold this myth of these modular nuclear reactors and how they're going to be so cheap. And they're saying, oh, yes, they'll be ready. And then they start talking about fusion power. And we were given this ludicrous story about the nuclear ignition facility in California and how they got more energy out than in. Well, they didn't bother to add up the energy required to fire the laser. They got about a hundredth of the energy out that they put in when you take that into consideration. There is actually the possibility of fusion power being developed at MIT over in the States. That's a tokamak design that's completely different, and that's going to take ages too. But right now, we've got solar panels, we've got heat pumps, we've got energy storage. We reduce traveling so much, especially on planes. You know, I gave up flying for about 10 years when I realized how bad it was. It's a bit like self-inflicted harm, but, you know, I just felt I had to do it. It's a bit tricky, though, when you've got relatives in the United States. Anyway, sorry, rant over.
I totally agree, Dr. Phillips saying, because 11 years or 12 years ago now in Fukushima, what happened, and that's where the earthquake started and the tsunami hit building. And even now people can't go back to area. And we are not really equipped to handle that kind of accident. Definitely not in Japan. And still people are suffering because of that accident.
Yes, when I started my research in Hiroshima, it was actually the year of Fukushima. And there was an extraordinary outpouring of empathy from the nuclear survivors of Hiroshima to new nuclear survivors of Fukushima. So it was quite an extraordinary coalition of these two issues, energy and nuclear weapons use. I wonder if any more questions have come in, or is there anything another panelist would like to say on the previous question?
Could I just say about Fukushima, when I've just put a link to the article I wrote about Zaporizhia, and there was a lot of suppression of information by the authorities in relation to Fukushima, and it was chaotic. And at one point, they evacuated people to an area for their safety, and it was actually a higher radiation because they didn't know where the radiation had gone. And they were relying on overflights by the Americans to monitor the radiation. And the nuclear authorities deliberately suppressed information and wouldn't tell people what was going on. It was an indictment not just of nuclear power, but the way it was controlled as well. And I could give references to that.
Yes, I think one of the points I wanted to make overall with this discussion is that nuclear weapon, anything to do with nuclear, and especially nuclear weapons, has nothing to do with freedom of speech. I think that we create, my research on Hiroshima has shown me that censorship of the Rebekusha stories at the beginning is really the reason why we went ahead with developing nuclear weapons, because if we'd had those stories, there would have been much more of an outcry against nuclear stockpiles and nuclear proliferation. So we now have a question about where can we find current risk assessments and data of the United Kingdom's nuclear warheads and military stockpiles? Open question. Bill, do you know that?
Well, there aren't any official ones because they deliberately don't produce them, and they deliberately won't acknowledge the possibility of nuclear winter, although we've continually asked the MOD about this. So they're ignoring one of the worst effects of nuclear weapons. But maybe Ben knows, but I can't. I mean, I would go to the Nuclear Information Service for that best assessment. It depends what risk you're thinking of, risk of actual use in warfare or risk of a transport accident. There's so many different type, or the risk in making them, or of the atomic weapons establishment boiling over, or what? That's the question. There's a range.
Maybe that person come back to this one.
I mean, I can just check.
I think, sorry, just to clarify, the question was about the risk of a transport accident.
Oh, so I don't think I can actually. No, I'm sure Janet will be able to signpost to some useful information about the convoy risk, because that is a very real risk which is massively underreported, which I know groups that she's working with will be able to help with. But just on the stockpiles issue, the UK has just increased its stockpile. I believe it's to 260 warheads. That's a 40% increase from the commitment they made to reduce it to, I think, 180. But they don't actually announce what the number is. So they're saying that the cap is 260, which, of course, is enough warheads to destroy the Earth many, many times over. But that information is published by government. I mean, it's a fragment of information. It's not really information at all. It's an indicator, but it's in the UK's Strategic Defence and Security Review. And the latest one of those was released in 2021, called the Integrated Review. If you type in Integrated Review on Google, you'll find what the UK is willing to say about its nuclear weapons.
Great. Thank you. So we're almost finished for the evening. So it remains for me, unless there are any more last minute questions, it remains for me to thank all the panelists for joining us this evening. I enjoyed all the talks. Milan, who unfortunately couldn't stay with us till the end, but his highlighting of the way in which nuclear threats have been made by this country as well as our so-called enemies, and could continue and are continue to be made as well. Kyoko's absolutely heartfelt experience of her own life as a Hiroshima second generation survivor, and the consequently intergenerational impacts of nuclear harms, not just physically but also psychologically. And Janet Fenton's really wonderful description of how WILF, the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, started, and how it came from women deciding that enough was enough. Unfortunately, Janet was also not well, so she couldn't complete her talk, but we hope that she'll join us on another occasion Dr. Phil Webber's really, really in-depth and precise analysis of not just the impacts of nuclear weapons in conflict, but also the impacts on the climate and the prospect of a second ice age due to the quantity of nuclear weapons that are now in the world. Elin's wonderful and amazing play about her own family's experiencing from this side of the world the intergenerational impacts of nuclear tests. And the awareness that those survivors have not been compensated, and that there is still an active campaign that we as journalists need to be more aware of. And I encourage everyone to see her play when it tours again. And finally, Ben's brilliant and very, 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 very current analysis of what is going on with the UK's nuclear deterrence policy and the way in which it's being played out on an international diplomatic level, and the seriousness with which we as a country and as journalists need to take this threat that this country itself is not paying heed to its own obligations under the Non-Proliferation Treaty. And I very much look forward to hearing more from Ben about the impacts of nuclear harms in former colonies in the future. We hope to share more with the people who've joined this event about potential recording that may be made available, and also maybe future events. Thank you so much for coming tonight.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody else. It was really inspiring.
Yep. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
We'll be closing soon. So thanks again.